Murawski, because we don't want to run out of time. My name is Joy Kaplan. I'm one of the interns here of a special education. And I co-wrote this grant in order to implement this program. And we're really excited about the six PDs that we're going to have. And I'd like to first introduce Marty Eisen, one way. Marty Eisen is a co-teacher here at Granada, science, biology, and physics. And he's been doing this for a very long time. He pretty much launched the program along with Dr. Murawski. And he is going to be our coordinator for co-teaching here at Granada. So he will be the go-to person from now on. I know you received a lot of emails from me. I'm sorry if I inundated you with them, but there were quite a few people on the waiting list, and I had to confirm everybody. So I'm so happy that you're all here. And in the future, Marty will be doing a lot of those emails. So now I would like to introduce Dr. Wendy Murawski. And as you all know, I'm going to let Wendy, tell all about herself. But I do just want to let you know that the bathrooms are behind you, if you need to use them. And we will be having dinner from Panera. Not quite sure when, but they will deliver. And I just wish you all a really great evening. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. How's everybody doing? Yay, good day at school? Nothing like getting professional development at night after a long day of school. Pretty sure you're stoked about being here. Thank God for food. Okay, but I'm Wendy Murawski, and I have been working with Granada for quite a few years, off and on, and I'm very, very excited about this program. When I was working with some of the administrators about the grant, they said, well, our goal is that we certainly want Granada High to become this amazing area for co-teaching. We want to be a model for other sites. But as we go along, we want to make sure that we're developing this community. And that's very much what this sixth series is going to be about. It's about developing all of us as a community. There hasn't been as much done on co-teaching at the high school level or at secondary as there has been at elementary. Because we have a whole new issue when it comes to having secondary kids, high content, standardized tests, assessments, things like that. So there will be a big focus on secondary as we continue. Quick introduction to myself. I am the Michael D. Eisner Endowed Chair and Executive Director for the Center for Teaching and Learning at Cal State Northridge, really close by. I'm a professor of special education, but the CTL, the Center for Teaching and Learning, is the research, collaboration, and professional development arm of the College of Ed. So hopefully some of you, when you came in, I'm going to grab this from you, you got this little flyer. This little newsletter, this is our T-Care newsletter. It's teachers connecting to advance retention and empowerment. It's really our national newsletter to help people stop burning out in education. So please, on the back of that, you'll see our website and our email as ctl@csun.edu. If you'll email us, you will be on the mailing list, and we will send you T-Care, we'll send you some other things. We've got professional development free. We have people coming in like Temple Grandin. That's pretty exciting. February 6th, put it on your calendar. And we have a big What Really Works in Education conference, and it's focused on working with exceptional learners, like students with disabilities, students who are English language learners, twice exceptional students. And we're having that next semester as well. So get on our mailing list. We don't spam or do any of that kind of fun stuff. It'll just be about giving you publications and telling you about presentations that are coming up. Okay, so in a nutshell, I've been a secondary co-teacher for years and years and years. Now I'm at CSUN. I talk about it, I write about it, I research it. And tonight, we're going to be kind of talking about all of that together. I want you to know the overview of this. This is not a one-time deal. This is a six-evening commitment so that we can take this journey together. So you'll see the dates up there. Hopefully you already know these dates, and this is not a surprise to some of you. But if you need to take a picture of it, you can do so. These also have the topics we'll focus on. Tonight is demystifying co-teaching. So some of you have taken classes from me, have had lots of presentations on co-teaching, you know what it is, and you're gonna feel like, I know this, I don't have to sit there and hear about co-teaching. That's not how I plan to do these evenings. These evenings are gonna be a lot more about dialogue, about what does it mean to you, what are you working with, what's not happening at your high school or your middle school if you're there, and how can we learn from one another? So that's our goal as we go along. You'll notice that we're gonna talk about co-planning, co-instructing, we're gonna talk about data and the C-time process. I'll be rolling that out little by little. C-time stands for co-teaching improvement model of excellence. So no matter where you guys are, we want you to be able to improve by the end of the year. And then differentiation, of course, and co-assessing. With all of those, I'll be bringing in some strategies, but hopefully you guys will be bringing in your strategies in addition to your questions. Like I said, we're trying to build a community here. I will consider this group our co-teaching professional learning community, or PLC. So if I talk about our co-teaching professional learning community, it's this large group right now. And then within that, we have these communities of practice. For some of you, for example, how many people are here from Cleveland? You know, at least one person, two people, okay. All right, you guys might be your only community of practice. What's another school who's represented here, besides Granada?
Northridge Academy High
School. All right, Northridge, Nas, good. Northridge Academy High School, good. You guys then would be your community of practice. Some of you guys will have small groups, some of you will have large groups, and as we go along, we may even start to develop ones across subjects. So I've worked with Los Angeles Unified School District, and we were looking at focus schools and trying to build communities of practice within that. So again, bigger group with broader issues is gonna be our professional learning community, and smaller groups with shared concerns, shared issues, kind of work groups to improve, those will be communities of practice. Everybody good with the lingo? All right, good. So I want to know who you guys are. I want to know what the schools are that are represented. I know we have Cleveland. I know we have Nas. Who else do we have? Birmingham. Where's everybody from Birmingham? All out of one table. Excellent. Oh, and two tables. They don't like you very much, but that's okay. By the end of six seasons or six evenings, we'll get you over there. All right, who else?
Cesar Chavez.
Cesar Chavez. Where? That table? Spread out, I want to see where you guys are, excellent. I am a huge fan, not just because of the work he did, but mainly because his birthday is celebrated on my birthday. So I get my birthday off every day, every year. All right, I wish it was every day. Okay, who else?
Granada.
Granada, let me hear you from Granada, where are you? Raise your hand, Granada, come on, let me see you guys. Okay, excellent. Who else?
Bethune Middle School.
Okay, where are you? Bethune, is this the table? No, one? Good for you, stand proud. All right, who else?
Vaughn,
Next Century Learning Center, awesome. Where's Vaughn? Okay, this table, just you? Okay, you'll have a friend. I think there were a couple of you, stand up.
Polytechnic High School.
Polytechnic High, okay, who else is from Polytechnic High? Just two, all right, who else?
James Monroe High School.
James Monroe High School, Monroe High School, who's from there? Good? All right, come on, who else, guys? I'm trying to make sure I know who's here. Say it again.
Discovery Prep High School.
Discovery Prep High School. Okay, who's from there? All right, a few there. What else?
Jefferson High School.
Jefferson High School. One. All right. Okay, wait, you're coming next?
Catch High School.
Catch High School. Anybody else? Oh, good, a whole group from there. Excellent.
We're from Camino Nuevo.
From?
Camino Nuevo.
Camino Nuevo?
Yes.
Camino Nuevo. Okay, who's there? All right, group here, awesome, like the sparkle fingers. Oh, and she is too, yes, sparkle fingers. Excellent, well done, young lady. Okay, she is with you guys from Camino Nuevo. Say it again.
View Park High School,
make sure she raises her hand up high. View Park High School, woohoo, Yeah, well done. I like your co-teacher. It's going to make a good team. Anybody else? All right, this next question is going to be easier. If you primarily, and by the way, special educators, some of you, your arms might get tired, but that's okay. But if you primarily work in language arts or English, raise your hand. If you primarily teach, co-teach in English. Okay. If you primarily teach, co-teach in math. Okay, wow, lots. Okay, if you primarily teach, co-teach in science. All right. If you primarily teach, co-teach in social studies. All right, excellent, good. All right, give me some other areas that you teach or co-teach so I know. Oh, special education, and I'm talking about teach, co-teach, co-teach. Because I know we've got at least a team that's co-teaching in special ed. All right, good. All right, what else? Co-teach in Spanish? Still waiting for somebody to co-teach in German. Because I totally got you there. We'll do it together, Joy. All right, anybody else?
Social skills.
Okay, social skills. Excellent. Any other areas? Because as we talk, it helps me to know what areas we're going to need to cluster people. Fantastic. Let's move on. All right, today's takeaway. What is it? Baby steps. Marty has heard me say this a million times. I am a huge fan of baby steps. So as we go along through this process of these 6 evenings together, some of you have co-taught a long time, and you'll be fine. You will take this information. You will run with it. You will share things about your experiences that make other people look at you like, holy cats, or whatever they're thinking. But there's no way I'm going to be able to do that. And maybe you're not going to be able to do that this year. That's okay. Everybody here is at a different place. So what I'm hoping that you will do is you will take wherever you are and take baby steps to get better. Because we're doing this for students. We're also doing it for our own sanity. Okay? But primarily for students. So baby steps wherever you are. That's your takeaway. Don't get overwhelmed by anything anybody else says. Some schools here have been doing this for a long time. My agenda for all of the evenings is going to be that there's going to be the topic, like today is demystifying co-teaching, and next time we meet will be on co-planning. So there'll always be a topic that I'm focused on. Today is the more general one. But it's not going to be as much about me talking to you for 2 hours with a lunch break or a dinner break. It's really going to be about me facilitating, giving some information, but also asking some questions, guiding, bringing in strategies and resources, but also hoping that you guys will come in with strategies and resources to share with this group as well. So if you found something that works for you and your partner in co-planning and you're excited about it, please bring it next time. If you find the most perfect differentiation strategy that you have used in your Algebra 2 class, bring it in. We're going to want to know that stuff so that we're sharing with one another. So that's kind of the goal here. For this kind of discussion, I will be the facilitator, and what that means is I'm going to be allowed to cut you off. So we have a couple people who are the sharers of the group. We like you for the first 5 minutes. And after that, we want you to shut up. Let somebody else. So I will take that job. I can do it. I don't mind. I will be the one who says, thanks so much, Marty. We've had a lot. Thanks, buddy. Let's move on. Because I am going to have to watch our time, and there are going to be a lot of questions, and I'm going to start trying to gauge what we need to spend more time on and what don't we. Okay? So that will be my role, and don't be offended if I do it to you. I'm planning to do it as needed. I'm hoping to have time at the end of every session for a little Q&A, for a chance for you guys to ask either me or to ask each other. You're going to have my email. You're also going to have Marty's email. He has lots of experience with co-teaching, and like Joy mentioned, he's going to be the co-teaching coordinator, not just for Granada, but he's also working these sessions and making sure that they're logistically sound, I think. But if you have questions about co-teaching, you can funnel them to him, he'll get them to me, or you can ask me directly, and we'll go from there. Thumbs up that we're good? Any thumbs down? Excellent. I don't know what I would do about that. Suck it up. This is what we're doing. Okay, so is having 2 people in the room enough to qualify as co-teaching?
No.
Do some schools think it is?
Yes.
Is that happening in some places?
Yes.
Yes, in some places we've just got two physical adults in the room coexisting. And they're calling it co-teaching, okay? And then we've upped the ante a little bit so that in some places what they feel like is, well, as long as it's a general ed teacher and a special ed teacher, it must be co-teaching. Okay, is that true? Of course not. What are the kinds of things that you are seeing in the classroom where there are two people there, but you wouldn't say it's co-teaching? Someone want to share? That is not co-teaching. It's two people, but you would not say it's co-teaching. One thing I forgot to mention, guys, is that, and you signed it, and you should know this, but we are being videotaped, and we're live-streamed in case people missed this, and then it will be videotaped and used for other people who have missed it. I tell you that not to discourage your participation. I'm hoping you will still participate, but it also means that I will always be going over to you with the microphone because we do need to make sure that we're getting your questions and answers and that everybody hears, okay? So, what's your name?
Joy.
Joy, okay, Joy, tell us, what's something where you've seen it? Two people in the room, not co-teaching.
When one teacher is teaching and the other one is just kind of there, maybe helping, maybe not, maybe.
Joy, I think you have, you're the only person in this room with that experience. No one else has ever seen that happen. Right, guys? Let's make complete fun of her because that never happens in the room, ever. Anybody want to say something other than that? That's what we see a lot, right? Yeah, what's your name?
Erin. When one teacher does all the planning and all the decision making and all the grading and the other person has no say.
Again, only your experience. Because most high school teachers I know are really excited to share all the time. Their classrooms, the students, the grading, they love it. All right, anybody else? All right, hold on to those thoughts because we are going to come back to that question. All right, so it's not enough to have two adults in the room. It doesn't matter if it's gen ed and special ed. And by the way, I will sometimes say that gen ed, special ed, I will not call you regular educators because if you're regular ed, that makes us irregular, and that may be very true of some of us, but and we wear it proudly, but really it's better to say general education, special education. And by the way, every kid is general ed first. They're all our kids, and then some of them get additional services because of their special needs. So true co-teaching takes three things. Some of you have done this a lot and you know that this is what co-teaching is supposed to be. For some of you, this is, you're here tonight because you want to learn what co-teaching is. So if I were to have you walk away with anything tonight, I would have you walk away with these three things. Three things that you must do to co-teach. The first one is co-planning. So we already heard someone say, well, when one person does all the planning, all the grading, all the instructing, that's not co-teaching. That's accurate. So what do we actually see happening a lot related to co-planning? What are people doing or not doing? Go ahead, give me, what's your name? I'm gonna do this right here. What's your name?
I'm Maureen.
Maureen, okay.
And basically they're just not, they don't have time to get together and plan number one, and yeah.
And yet, so it's not happening. It's essentially what she's saying. Maureen's saying they don't have time to plan together, but they're just not co-planning together. Do you guys see that as an issue? Okay, and next time we're going to talk about, when we meet again next time, we'll talk about what are some of the issues of finding time, and also then how do you use your time more efficiently to plan. But we do, in order for it to be true co-teaching, real co-teaching, it's not your way or my way. It doesn't matter if you have taught math for 27 years and I'm a special educator coming in my first year teaching. I'm still supposed to bring something to the table. In fact, I think I still do bring something to the table, but I need to have the option of co-planning with you so that I'm able to bring in some of those ideas. Second thing is we're supposed to co-instruct. So both of us are in front of the kids. If you don't have both of you up in front of the kids, what happens?
They rely more on one.
I'll get here, one and then two. What's your name?
Maria.
They rely more on one teacher than the other.
Okay, they rely more on one teacher than the other. What's another one? What's your name?
Strong. They, the kids
show more respect to the other teacher. Lack of respect for the teacher that's doing nothing.
Yeah, because if one of you always gets FaceTime, even if the other person's doing a lot of behind the scenes work, kids don't see that. And then what we end up doing is we go over and say, hey, can I help you? And he says, no, I'll wait for the real teacher. And you're not allowed to hit kids. So there goes that strategy. So like they both said, it's not just that, you know, one of them is seen as the real teacher, it's also a lack of respect. They start to feel like you are the assistant, you are the aide. Paraprofessionals do a lot of work, and they should get a lot of respect for the work they do. However, if you are here as a credentialed general education or special education teacher, you've gone to school to know how to plan, to teach, to assess. And you should be seen as a teacher, not as an assistant. And that's why we know a lot of special educators burn out. So we co-plan, we co-instruct, and the last thing we do is we co-assess. We have to look at the grading. We have to see, are the kids learning this stuff? We also have to co-assess each other. Did you tick me off today? Did I do your pet peeve? So now you're really annoyed and you don't want to work with me again? That's co-assessing the kids and co-assessing each other. Those are the three things we must be doing in order to be truly co-teaching. Major tenets of co-teaching. I will tell you there are six things. And I'm going to ask you the question of what percent, because a lot of you are math people. Where are my math people? Raise your hands. It's a percent problem. Are you guys happy? I'm about to ask you math. Okay, what percent of these do you think we do well nationally? We are supposed to have parity. Oh, you know what? This is not going to be the percent problem. That's coming up in a minute. Sorry, I know you got you so excited about math. Sorry. All right, these are the things we're supposed to do. We're supposed to have parity, meaning we're supposed to be equals. You don't trump me, I don't trump you. Okay, could you stand up for a minute, Strong? What's going to happen when we disagree? Right? And yet, he doesn't trump me. He doesn't win just because he's big and kind of intimidating. He's a big teddy bear. Sit down. All right. I'm not even having you stand up. See how nice I am? Right? All right. It's not about size. It's not about years of teaching. It's not about who's louder, who's quieter, who the kids like better. We are equals. And that's really important because honestly, a lot of times with high school, we're talking about content. And I totally get that the person who's taught science for 30 years and has years of experience, has a master's degree, a doctorate, whatever, and then is looking at somebody else going, you don't even know science. Right? The whole stoichi, what? Stoichiometry? Never heard of it. But I'll co-teach it with you, yeah. Right? And then some of us are looking at this stuff going, I haven't done that level of math since I was in school, and even then I kind of struggled. But we're equals. So one of the things we're going to have to do is figure out how do we take that equality and use it so that we're using our strengths. Because each of us has something we bring to the table. And sometimes it's not the content. Sometimes it's a strategy. Sometimes it's differentiation. Sometimes it's the kids like us. Sometimes it's we know parents and we do well with parents. But we got to figure out what that is. We have our shared expertise, our shared resources, and even time. I can't work on Tuesday nights because I'm taking a class at CSUN and your partner goes, you know what, I'll take the grading on Tuesday nights. Awesome. All of these things need to be shared. I've already mentioned that we need to share the planning, the instructing, and the assessing. And then another major one, and this is the one at the high school level I think often we're missing. Most often we're missing. We get two people, they like each other, they're in there, they're co-teaching, they're having a ball, they're having the kids do different things, they're enjoying it. And yet what I'm still not seeing, and this is from a national perspective, I'm still not seeing true differentiation. I see grouping. I see that when it comes to testing, some kids get to get pulled out and have it read to them or have extra time. But that's it. That's the level. Where's the specially designed instruction? Where are we truly doing something different in this class of 40 kids? And that's hard to do, but I will tell you it's almost impossible to do if you have one teacher. With two teachers, you guys have a shot. And that's what we want to try and figure out how to do so that, again, you keep your sanity and you're effective with kids. All right, here's your math problem. So these are the components that are supposed to be in co-teaching. And we do a percentage of these very, very well. Get two or more adults together. Make sure they are both professionals, credentialed teachers. Have them collaborate. Have them share the instruction in the classroom. Have a diverse group of students. And have them in the same physical space, meaning the same classroom. What percent of these do you guys think we do really, really well nationally? Okay, so a percent of, let's see, there are six bullets. So that's 1/6 if you're saying just two or more. Somebody said 50% because they somehow managed to take one of those bullets and, oh no, they did three. Okay, so they're saying we got three of the six. What did you say? 66.67%, 2/3. That it's 2/3. Actually, 2/3, we don't do well. Only 2/3. 4/6. 2/3 we do very, very well, and 1/3 we don't do well at. Because we are, in terms of having two or more adults, we rock at that. Schools have no problem taking two or more teachers and sticking them in the same room with a bunch of kids. Yeah, 2/3, that's pretty good, right? The whole collaborating, sharing instruction thing we seem to struggle with. But we have a lot of schools. Do you know that co-teaching is the number one way nationally that schools, and this is K-12, that schools are addressing the needs of students with disabilities in the general ed class? This is the number one way that we're doing inclusion, that we are including kids with disabilities, and schools say, well, we do co-teaching. And yet what we find is we do putting two adults in the same room, not even always for the whole period, right? But they're there for some time. And somehow we've got magic fairy dust, so that by doing a drive-by on kids, we're really able to share those, save those disabilities that they've had since birth. Yes, no problem. All right, so those of you who want to go more in depth on any strategies, I have this completely random, non-biased, professional research-based suggestion for a book study. Completely random. You could pick Collaborate, Communicate, and Differentiate by Murawski and Spencer, or Collaborative Teaching in Secondary Schools I hear is phenomenal, very funny, very helpful by Murawski. And then Leading the Co-Teaching Dance is another one that's about for administrators, and that is by Murawski and Deeker. Any of these books, I brought a whole bunch of things up here for resources. For those of you guys who are at a beginning level of co-teaching, and you're feeling like we really need more on how do you set it up, how do you do this, how do we have the right scheduling, how do we have the right planning, all of that kind of stuff, you can go into that. For right now, I just want us to start moving into some more questions. You should have picked up three things when you came today. You picked up the flyer for our T-Care, the T-Care newsletter. You picked up a sheet of paper that goes along with the PowerPoint. And then you also picked up a sheet of paper that has questions on co-teaching. Because like a very good special educator, I wanted you to have some of these to follow along with in your own notes. And I'm hoping that some of you are going to be very helpful in sharing some of the answers. My first question is, and I'm hoping somebody will share, what did you think co-teaching was before you actually got started co-teaching? Somebody think back. And I know Granada, that was, what, 11 years ago, something like that? But if you heard about co-teaching, what did you think it was before you actually started co-teaching? I need a help. Okay, I know Joy. That's good. Get us started. Thank you.
I literally thought it was two teachers in the room teaching. So both having their own desk, both having their own, they participate. I thought it was two teachers teaching.
And now you don't? Now you're getting realistic. All right. Okay, so two teachers teaching, both having their own desk. Love that. What's your name?
Kelly. No, two teachers who have the same skill level. So if I was just to be in a chemistry class, I should have chemistry.
Right, okay.
Resource for social development.
100%, yeah. Special educators at the high school level not only have to know chemistry, we also have to know all the different math, science, we have to have read all of the different English books, and we have to know kids with learning disabilities, emotional behavioral disabilities, ADHD, autism, Tourette's syndrome, Prader-Willi, and you name it, right? ZYXOVUT, SRQPON, MLKJIHD, FEDCBA syndrome. And no one will. And by the way, parents have to like us. And we have to know how to write IEPs and have time for that. And coach cheerleading. At least that was my experience, right? Okay. No problem. We can do all this. All right. So good. We're supposed to be at the same skill level. What else? What else did you think co-teaching was when you heard it? Because it's interesting to me, because it's interesting to me how many times when I'm talking about co-teaching, I will have entire schools who will then say to me, oh, we didn't think it was that. So it's interesting to me what people have thought it was. What's your name?
This is interesting because I was asked to co-teach 12 years ago, half in row. So, but I was told go in and co-teach after 2 months. So it's after the school's in 2 months, and they said go in and co-teach. Okay, and I went in thinking I just had to help out the special ed kids. That's it.
Right.
That's what I was told. So that was my first experience of co-teaching.
Just go in and do it.
Just go in and help the special ed kids learn some type of math.
Right.
That was it.
I think that sounds totally reasonable. A lot of times that is what people think. You just go do it. And so when you walk in, when I walk into a class and I see the special educator only helping the kids with disabilities, you could judge and you can say, you know, you're not doing your job. Most of the time, it's that they didn't know they weren't supposed to just be doing that. And the general education teacher has no idea that they could be doing something else either. I have a funny little story, Lee. I don't know that you may or may not remember this, but you were in a class of mine on co-teaching collaboration at Cal State Northridge. And the reason I remember this distinctly is there was an individual in that class, names will not be given at this point, but he sat toward the front. And I remember very, very clearly that at one point he said in class, why do you spend so much time talking about collaboration and co-teaching? I know it's your thing, but people aren't co-teaching, right? That's not happening. You're into it because you did it and you're spending all this time and we have to learn about it. And you became my hero when, as I'm fuming inside thinking about what diplomatically in a class on collaboration and communication can I say to this jerk, sweet man who clearly was deluded, but I paused trying to reflect what I say, and you, I don't know if you stood up, but you said pretty loudly from the back, dude, you said his name, but whatever, I'm at your school and I'm co-teaching. It is happening. He had no idea it was even happening at Monroe High School at that time, but I was really happy with you that day, so thank you. Yes. Because we're in silos, sometimes you'll be at a school and you'll have no idea that co-teaching is going on because it's just one small team over here and they're working their butts off and they're doing a great job, but it's not systemic and it's not sustained. So if our administrators don't know what co-teaching is supposed to be, then a lot of times it's just on the back of one, maybe a special educator who went to a buddy and said, hey, you want to co-teach? And that's exactly how I started at a high school in Virginia. I went to an English teacher and said, you want to co-teach? And she said, what's that? And I said, we get to hang together for at least one period and we get to teach together. Well, you know, I'll help you grade and I'll help you plan. And she's like, they let you do that these days? And I'm like, yeah, they actually encourage it. So that's how I started co-teaching. What's your name?
I'm Lauren Gordon.
Lauren.
Okay, I was just going to let you know, I'm here that have co-teaching, it's true co-teaching. We weren't sure if we were gonna get anything out of this. We collaborate, we are pushing for money to sit down and work together. We have meetings, so we have department meetings with our gen ed teachers and special ed teachers. So I think we're doing something right.
Yes.
We're hoping to glean something new here.
Oh, I'm sure you will.
Thank you.
And if nothing else, you've learned that he put somebody in their place back in the day. It's quite a few years ago. All right, so that's what co-teaching was before we even got started. What about now that you've been co-teaching? What kind of co-teaching experiences have you had where you're in it and somebody told you, this is co-teaching, this might even be happening right now at your school. where you say, wait a minute, this isn't what I've learned co-teaching is supposed to be. Are any of you in a situation right now where you're kind of thinking, based on what we, especially what we just talked about, you're supposed to co-plan, co-instruct, co-assess. Are you in a situation where you're willing to share? Good. What's your name?
Lindsay.
My very first year teaching at Birmingham as a special ed teacher, I went into the room to introduce myself to the co-teacher, and I was all excited. And I said my name, and I'm here to co-teach with you. And she said, oh, you don't need to be here.
Awesome.
Thank you so much. Welcome to Birmingham.
Wow.
Yeah. And there's also a time when I used to, not this year, but in years previous, where you go into the room as the co-teacher, and then the other teacher is doing all the teaching, and then when they're done talking, you're
allowed to walk around.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that your experiences are probably very similar to other people's here. And there was a comment made earlier about, you know, when one person does all the planning and instructing and grading, sometimes it's because there are control issues. Sometimes, but, and I'm not being sarcastic here, it's not all the time. So I was co-teaching at a high school in Burbank, and when I did my dissertation, I had a special educator, female, young special educator, had a couple male English teachers, because I had to have a variety of different, you know, variables going on, so she was teaching special ed only in English. She also went in and co-taught with a couple different people. Well, one of them she was struggling with, and he was a dynamic, nice English teacher, but he wouldn't let her do anything. Well, I found out in my study, because I was interviewing them later, and she's frustrated. She's like, you know, I'm doing all this stuff in these other classes. He won't let me do anything. He liked her. He thought he was being nice, because she's so busy all the time. She has IEPs, and she has this, and she has that. So I'm just going to do it all. They ended up getting married. Aww. And I just prayed for her that he continued that I'm going to do it all mentality. Jury's still out on that one, but... But the frustrating, and now how many of you have had a situation yourself where you have worked with a partner who has pretty much said, I've got this, you don't have to do anything? A couple of you? Or hasn't let you do anything and you've wanted to? Okay, some of you are like, I don't want to, because they're right there. All right, so as we continue this, remember, we're talking about demystifying co-teaching, and part of it is going to be being able to say to somebody, here's my role. Now, I get that you know chemistry better than I do, or you know social studies better than I do. I'm good with that. But here's what I'm bringing to the table. And if you're the general ed teacher and you're thinking, wait a minute, this person doesn't stand up. They don't walk around. They don't help. They're just back there acting like an aide. You need to know how to say to that person, step up, in a really nice diplomatic way. I was an advocate just recently at an IEP meeting, and I was at a school, and at the school, and they didn't all know who I was. I was just there as a friend of a parent, and the special educator said, I'm in the English and math classes, so it's fine. I will be there. And I'm like, oh, awesome. They're in there. They're co-teaching. And I said, tell me, you know, are you co-teaching? She said, what? Yes. And I said, well, oh, good. Tell me what you do. And she said, I sit in the back, and then as soon as the teacher is done talking. What are you, chopped liver? Right? Aren't you a teacher too? But as soon as the teacher is done talking, then I walk around to help kids. So why are we surprised if the kids feel like you're not a real teacher? Okay. I want to introduce the co-teaching core competencies. And we're going to do this for a few minutes. We're going to really look at what co-teaching is supposed to be. And again, it sounds like some of you have a lot of experience with co-teaching and you're here to glean some new stuff. And others of you, this is going to be relatively new to you. The co-teaching core competencies are 22 core competencies that my colleague Wendy Lochner and I developed. It actually comes from 4 domains, 11 strands, and 120 competencies for co-teaching, of which we pulled out 22 for you to become an expert at. These are what we call core, so these are the main ones. What we're gonna do is you're gonna all get this piece of paper, you're gonna be allowed to take it home, put it under your pillow, memorize it, love it, let it become your best friend, or at the minimum, don't lose it before you leave here tonight. Okay, just take it with you. When we come back next week, and as we continue, we're going to actually do some self-analysis on these core co-teaching core competencies, so you guys will get a chance to see how you think you are doing with these. Granada has already been exposed to these. They've even done a self-analysis. They videotaped themselves, and they've done a reflection. So Granada, I'm going to ask that you guys are my group leaders right now. I would like all Granada Hills co-teachers to stand up and come on down. Don't worry, you don't have to answer anything. You just got to look pretty. Come on. Give them a round of applause. Granada co-teaching co-teachers. Come up here. Come up here. Good. Excellent. So they're going to stand behind me, and I'm going to tell you guys what you're going to do, because this is the first time they're hearing it, too. Go on, Marty. You got to work, too, bud. Yeah, wave to the camera, smile, nod. Make sure you stand at an angle, lean back. There you go. There you go. Nice. Yeah, you got to good. Get your good side. Excellent. So here's what we're going to do. Oh, look at Mel trying to get by his co-teacher. How cute is that? All right. I have these handouts that are the co-teaching core competencies. I'm going to give a couple of these to each of the Granada co-teachers. So all of you here are going to have to go find a buddy. Probably, I'm thinking there might be about two people per Granada teacher. Okay, so I'll give you each three or four of these. And in fact, I'll start, Mel, with you. Would you just take four and then pass them down? And then what you guys are going to do is you're going to get in small groups. Use the room. Spread out. Use the room. And you're just going to each get your co-teaching core competencies and then just start scanning them. Have a conversation about which of these are easy for you. You've already mastered them. You're fine. Which of them are new? You didn't expect them to be on the list. Or you're really struggling with a few of them. For what reason? Is it because your administration isn't supporting, or you don't have the schedule, or you just don't like them? That's up to you. Okay, so what we're gonna do again is you guys are gonna find one of these people to get a piece of paper from, and then you stand in a small group of about 2 to 4 people, okay, just 2 to 4 people, and have a conversation. There's no list of things you have to talk about. It's just sharing where you are, which of these competencies are working for you and not. Any questions about what we're doing? Granada people, are you good with this? Okay, so let people come, yeah, let people come to you. I'll help you pass some stuff out. Let's get it from the other side. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, let me get a little group here.
Four, right?
Four.
Yeah, 3 or 4. Two, let's just start with 3. There you go. There you go. Would you give her some? There you go.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, go find a partner. Find somebody, go to somebody, and then spread out. They can find you, you can find them.
just gone, period. And so I was saying that ours is, like his, for example. And so ours here, I've been with Strawn for 3 periods a day.
Right.
That makes such a big difference.
Big difference.
Establishing a relationship and figuring out roles and who's doing what.
And, so, and then also in terms of scheduling, when you're thinking about kids with disabilities, now if you have, say, 30% of the class 3 times, you might have covered all the kids in math who need that math. Kids with disabilities, they're taken, right? It's not like you have one period with you and then they go over and there's another group that has a period with a different team and a different team. It makes it a whole lot makes more sense because it's one team planning one time, but they're covering 3 times as many students.
Thank you.
6 evenings. Sometimes I'll have you working with just your school. Sometimes it'll be across, more heterogeneous like that just was. And sometimes it'll be very specific. So there are going to be times even after lunch where I'm going to get you with content specific so that you'll be able, again, to develop this community of other people who are in a similar situation as you, maybe even co-teaching in the same subject that you're teaching so that you'll be able to share it with one another. Related to the co-teaching core competencies, what were some, and I know some of the conversations were just introducing one another and figuring out situations, but what were some of the things that you discussed that you saw that maybe either you liked, you didn't like, you saw? Yeah, what's your name? I'm always going to ask names so we get it here.
I'm Eric. We talked a lot about the time necessary to do the co-planning. That seems to be a sticking point somehow.
Huh. Really? Fascinating. Anybody else find it hard to find time to go plan? Apparently you are not alone. Go figure. Yes, Rob.
Strong Joseph. We looked at 5.7, a variety of instruction approaches. A lot of were kind of curious, my group was kind of curious what that was.
Oh, good.
So that was there, I kind of.
And I heard you explaining some of the ones you guys do. So the instructional approaches, and again, this is not so much going to be like a co-teaching one-on-one sort of thing. It is in the beginning because we're demystifying a little bit. But we will talk after lunch a little bit about the approaches. I'm not going to teach you what they all are, but we're actually going to have you get in subject-specific groups to talk about what they might look like in algebra, in social studies, in English 9, in, you know, math, etc. So we will talk about what those are, but that's kind of a big cornerstone of co-teaching is it's not just one teach, one support. It's not one person up front while one person just glides around the room and says, oh, honey, I'm so glad you brought your book today. That doesn't actually help them or help them with their special need access the general ed curriculum. Okay, what else? What were some other conversations about the co-teaching core competencies? Yes, good. Hang on, here I come. I know, but they want this for the the taping. Your name first.
My name is Roman. And we talked about the we language and also co-owning a classroom and how for some teachers, it's easier to share the we and the collaboration in the classroom versus, you know, like rookies versus veterans kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. So we language means we're saying, we want you guys to get out your books. We need you to do your homework. We don't understand why you're in 10th grade and you still don't know a noun from a verb. Rather than, I'm getting frustrated. I want you to. It shows parity in that you guys share the classroom. But I think, like Robin said, a lot of times what it comes down to is teachers who are so used to teaching by themselves that it's not that they don't, you know, care about you and want to show you your equals. They're just not used to saying we instead of I. That goes both general ed and special ed. The sharing of the classroom and being able to say that even if you guys are together for only one period, that one period, it's both of our rooms. One of the videos I have a wonderful video that maybe at some point we'll get to see where I see Mr. Eisen and Mr. Zernow here at Granada Hills, and they have Mr. E and Mr. Z up right by the board. And I like showing that because it's such an easy visual depiction to the students that we're equals. And even if they're only together for that period, the other periods kids go, who's Mr. E? And Mr. Z can say, I co-teach within fourth period. Done, move on. But those are the kind of things that help show parity. Let me give you one other that you guys should be super careful about. You are both co-teachers. It's not teacher co-teacher. And I hear that with people saying, the teacher did this and the co-teacher did that. Whoa, it's not like pilot co-pilot. Right? Nah. So typically I say, well, who is the co-teacher? The general ed teacher or the special ed teacher? Okay, so we're both co-teachers, the general ed co-teacher, the special ed co-teacher. Or in some of the schools I work with, they have general ed. They have two math teachers together, or they have an English and a social studies teacher together. Okay, in Harlem, I was working with the elementary, and so they were having two kinder teachers and two first grade teachers. Okay, so it's people are pairing up a lot of things, but you're both equals, co-teachers. What's another one on the co-teaching core competencies? Any other conversations that you had? I talk to you, and I'll go one and then two. Excellent. What's your name?
My name's Brenda, and we were talking about a variety of these core competencies, but also the difficulty in, especially the ones that were the special, the you can't tell the difference between the two educators, and when it came into the idea of like having the special ed teacher and the general ed teacher, and then how would you have a special ed teacher co-teaching five different subjects?
We don't understand. How would you have a special educator co-teach five different subjects? What's the answer?
No.
You don't. You don't actually do it. They're special educators, two special educators together all day. But in terms of a special education teacher who's supposed to, and this happens frequently, because an administrator doesn't necessarily understand what this is about, they think all special educators doing is going from one room to another. And if my job were truly to walk around and say, oh, I like that you brought your book, that's nice, turn to page 97, honey, that's what she said. If that were my job, yeah, I can do that with five different people, but that's not my job. My job, if it's co-teaching, is to?
Co-teach.
All right, break it down for me, folks, come on. First one, co-plan, co-instruct, co-assess. Can you do that with five different subjects? No, of course not. It would be me going to a general education teacher. Give me a general ed, I'm going to pick Mel, because I know you're right there. So Mel is a science teacher. It would be me going to him and saying, Mel, as your assistant principal, I am so excited this year. Buddy, I've got you hooked up. I know how much you love science. So I've got you teaching a biology class. I've got you teaching a chemistry class. I've got you teaching a astronomy class. I've got you teaching an earth science class. Give me another science, folks. Hello, I've got physics for you as well. Awesome, right?
Oh, great.
He's on it. He might be able to do all of that, but he's gonna die, right? He's capable. It's not that we can't go into all those classes. It's not that we're not capable educators. It's that we burn out and we can't do that level of planning with each one of them. Somebody is gonna feel like you're just dragging in like, I'm here. That's what you got, right? So we have to be more than that. So the answer is then we need to go back, talk to administrators and explain that, look, if we're truly co-teaching, co-plan, co-instruct, co-assess, we can do it with one or two partners. After that, we're becoming ineffective. Now, if you could do something like, I think Strawn and Eric, you guys are together for three periods. Yeah, three periods they're together. So if they co-plan once, they can co-plan for those three periods. Even if those were different, like if it was a math one, a math two, and a math three, at least they're together for three periods. We need our administrators to help us understand the streamlining. So some of this is what you're going to be coming back. Now, I know, I think Matt, you had.
Matt, yes.
Yeah, okay. Matt, tell us.
I was just going to say that something that I struggle with is, and we were talking about our group, was differentiation. And I would say that myself and Marty, who I co-teach with, differentiate pretty well over the course of days or weeks. And you can find differentiation in our instruction. But I find it really hard to find the time to differentiate every assignment, and not every assignment, but even a majority of assignments that should have something written down on a sheet of paper where there's differentiation on the paper, like maybe two different or three different assignments, on not on a daily basis, but like three times a week. Just, we know how to do it and do it well, but having the time to do it is really, really challenging. So I don't know how to do it.
Yeah. And I think that is a lot of what you guys are gonna find is you're gonna know. There's a lot of the stuff where you say, I know this, I know I should be doing this, or we should be doing this. How do we find the time? What was my takeaway for today? Baby steps. Baby steps. So part of it is going to be, I know that this is the first year, right, that the two of you guys are together? Second year.
Third year,
okay, third year. So is it better this year than it was your first year? You both concur? Excellent, good. So every year, as you have, and again, one of the things about high school is that secondary, I think a lot of us know there's the understanding that perhaps our lesson plans don't look exactly like the lesson plans we created when we were student teachers. They're a little different. Like, instead of Madeline Will's seven-step lesson plan, we're lucky we have seven words. Page 42, it's right there. I want to see your lesson plan. It's right there. 42, what about that do you not get? So part of it is going to be that even if we did one unit where we did a rock star job just because we were so excited about it and we came up with, yes, here's what our typical learners are doing and the kids we're scaffolding for and we've got enrichment and we've got it all, that's now in our back pocket for next year. Okay, so even if it was one unit this year, that's one unit that's better than we had before, and hopefully we're sharing that with the other science teachers, the other math teachers, whoever teaches that content, so that we're starting to build, and we need this community to build. All right, with that said, what we're gonna do now is I'm going to very, just a minute, don't get up yet, but I'm gonna release you to go back and get some food. We're gonna take about 30 minutes for you guys to get food, but please, think about meeting other people, have a conversation about what's happening at your school, and when we come back and do it as a group, we'll have some additional questions, and then like I said, one of the things I'm excited to get you guys into is some subject-specific groups to talk about what does this actually look like when you do it at your subject. So, Marty, any other things they need to know about the food?
Coffee, dessert, water here, lots of salad, bread, potatoes, mac and cheese, soup, apples.
Okay, if you guys would make sure you have your cookies and your coffee and go ahead and have a seat. Where did my clicker go? Teaching, so figuring out where you all are on this continuum of co-teaching. So you have the co-teaching core competencies. Let me also let you know, if you look at the bottom of that co-teaching core competency sheet, there is a website, co-teachsolutions.com. If you go to that website, you should have a, if you don't have one, Maybe you got it from the wrong group of papers, but I've got some up here, and it's got the website on it. I know that they had extras made. Does anybody not have? Who doesn't have? If you don't have a website, come up and get one of these that has the website. I'll stick it right here. Or Marty will help me by passing these ones out. The website has actually all the co-teaching competencies. So the four domains, the 11 strands, the 120 competencies, and then these core competencies. So if you want to see the whole thing, that's available for you at co-teachsolutions.com. I'm going to be sharing some resources with you as we go along, and I'm not always going to be able to print stuff out because I don't know who needs what, but I will let you know where these things are available so you can do that. So, next two questions. I want to find out from people, what is one thing about co-teaching that you didn't expect and it's a real challenge for you? You're struggling with it. And then the next question is going to be, what's one thing about co-teaching you didn't expect, but it's a benefit, it's a good thing. You didn't expect it, but it's a good thing. Well, let's start with the challenge and your name.
Susan, I think one of our challenges is being able to actually know how to come in together and actually teach in front of the kids together. And a real benefit this year has been the assessments and a lot of the differentiating. It's her real strong suit, and I think that that's really helped.
Awesome. Okay, so she, overachiever here, we have both questions answered. The challenge, and you know, I want to hear from all of you because so many times as I've been going around, what I hear at one table over here is the same thing I'm hearing at a table over here. You guys are sharing some of these concerns, and that is how the two people go in. We're both maybe used to teaching our own way. It's a challenge to figure out how do we do this together in front of a group of kids, okay? In front of students, how do we both feel like we both had some say in what we're doing and how we're doing it, and what do we do if one of us likes to do it one way, right? This is a conversation at the table. Well, what if, you know, we got a group over here who says, I like to do something one particular way, and our partner's like, yes, she does. But because they love each other, they figured out a way to make that work, and she's accommodating for her co-teacher's needs, right? And but that's important. I think that shows real co-teaching. So the challenge was how we both co-teach together. How do we actually share that space? But I love that you also shared that a benefit that she hadn't necessarily expected was both in the assessment and grading and in the differentiating. Because that's what the co-teacher, the special educator, I'm assuming, brought to the table that you don't necessarily always expect or know how that's going to benefit kids. So, all right, somebody else. You can choose to do both, or you can choose to do one or the other. Okay, Strong, tell us.
Co-planning. Real challenge.
I thought you were going to say it's a benefit.
No, it's a challenge because it's hard to have the same co-planning time as far as the period. Especially when I'm torn between two teachers. Both of them are great, but we struggle to get that right co-planning in that we think would be real beneficial.
So the co-planning, I'm gonna get that one first before we come to your child. By the way, did anybody else, when he said torn between two teachers, anybody else have the song? Yeah. Torn between two lovers going in their head? I gotta tell you. Torn between two lovers. And so one of my favorite articles, and actually it's the number one most downloaded co-teaching article, is an article I wrote with my friend Lisa Deeker, and it's called 50 Ways to Keep Your Co-Teacher. And it's based off of 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. So I got a whole article going in my head right now, torn between two. Okay, wait, I'll wait on that. Okay, I'll wait. All right, and so Strong, share with us too, anything about co-teaching that you didn't expect, but that has been a benefit to you. See anything?
Yeah, I would say the learning of the kids, how they are engaged more. And like today, we did an exercise, a debate, and we was like, oh man, how's this gonna go? And it was like, I was about ready to jump out, just jump up, because it was like, oh my God, you guys get it. The kids that you think wouldn't gonna get it, got it.
Got it. Awesome. Love that. Love that. All right, somebody else. Yes, back here. All right, Susan.
Robin. So one thing that I didn't expect to be a real benefit is just the overall behavior of students in the classroom.
classroom, and it feels like monitoring behavior is really easier, and even some of the students will help to, you know, like remind the other students in the classroom of times that are appropriate or inappropriate or help them when that's needed.
Excellent. So let me jump in and share with you that the research supports that. It supports that when we have two teachers in the room, first of all, typically teachers like it, kids like it, except, and I have research that I published in 2006 on this, where at the secondary and high school level, the kids like it, except that they don't get away with as much. Right, which, hello, turn around, is a huge benefit for the teachers. But another thing that we find is we can write positive behavior support plans all day long. We can write goals and objectives that say the student will not curse, the student will not throw their chair, the student will not do all these things. We can write 100 goals and objectives. They will never be as powerful as their peers looking at them going, dude, that's uncool. That's far more powerful, and that's what we have found with inclusive education overall, not just with co-teaching, but the fact that we're not going to really be able to teach social skills if we put all the students with autism in the same room, right? So these are huge benefits. So having two teachers to monitor behavior, to just walk around, you know, just the fact that I'm walking around, teacher, right? So that's a huge benefit. Let's get someone else over here. Mel.
Thank you. I have a preface on this thing by saying one of the main reasons I went into co-teaching. I was a brand new teacher, I'm a general ed teacher of science. And I thought, well, the classes I attended in special education, you know, for general ed, things made sense to me that this would be applicable to all teaching, not just special ed. And I knew Marty would be an excellent classroom manager, and I thought, wow, this is someone I can learn from. What I did not expect is that we worked together, we've been doing this work 12 years now, at least that 12 years earlier, is how much actually of a special educator I've become. There have been times where we'll be talking about a particular student, and I'll look at him just a little bit differently than Marty does, and I'll go, I think we can do something with this kid, and here's what we're gonna try. We try a lot of different things. And there are times where Marty is more of a special general ed teacher than me. We just go back and forth. But it really surprised me, you know, how much I could appreciate and understand and actually get into special education than what I understood before.
I think you two, having known you guys for so many years, you two really do, they're the paradigm of a special educator who has sort of morphed into a general educator, a general educator has morphed into a special educator, and they have a great experience together. Marty, I know that you have a student's story, if you want to share it, that because it goes so much along with Mr. Zernow saying that you guys look at kids a little differently. Do you want to tell a student story?
Sure. So the story Wendy's referring to is, can I use the student's name, or should I make it? You know, what is called student Bob. Bob is a...
Why don't you come up this way? That way everybody can kind of see you.
So Bob is a group home student. When we met him, probably reading, writing, math skills, all at the first grade, second grade level. Most of you Granada teachers know we get group home kids all the time, and they come for a week, a month, then they disappear for a week, a month, then they come back. And so we were teaching physics, and this kid walked in completely defeated. Being the special educator that I am, I spent the first 3 or 4 weeks trying my best to pull him outside. Pulling him outside, trying to, you know, encourage him to work. After about 5 weeks, I was done. Everybody had left the room, we closed the doors. I was like, Zerna, I'm done. I can't take this kid anymore. I've done everything I can. We've got all these kids in special ed. We've got all these kids in general ed who need help with physics. I can't handle this kid. He's yours if you want him. And Zerna could tell I was a little more heated when I said that than originally. And just a little more. Yeah, I was just a little more heated. And so I just couldn't get this kid to try. So a couple days go by, and Zerno goes, you know, Marty, I really think we can do something with this kid. Maybe And again, 10 years ago, I was blown away. 10 years, Mr. Zerna was very much a sink or swim physics teacher. If you don't learn it, oh well, it's on you. And I was very much the special educator trying to save everyone, get everybody in the academic canoe, so to speak. And so Zerna said, you know, he probably's not going to be a physicist someday, but maybe we can get him some life skills. So let's not quite give up on him. He waited a couple days to talk to me because I was a little overwhelmed. And I said, yeah, bro, whatever you decide, I'm in, you know. So literally for about 3 months, you know, we'd have a plan, we were teaching, and Zerna would be like, and this is a, he put a finger, and he'd be stepping outside with Bob while I continued the class. I'm like, all right. So 3 months go by and no change. He's really not investing. It's the next semester, and all of a sudden, and actually, oh, I forgot to mention, right around Christmas time, Zerna was like, hey, listen, I got him a Christmas present from both of us. It's not expensive, a little art book. He likes to do art. I'm trying to, you know, encourage him to do, you know, more art, things he loves. What do you think from both of us? I'm like, yeah, sounds great. So got him his Christmas present. Next semester, we start, end of January, he's trying. Middle of February, he's taking notes. I mean, this is a kid, we couldn't get him to do anything more than breathe. And I was like, he's taking notes. I was like, and then we went on a huge field trip to Magic Mountain. And this field trip is not holding hands. This field trip is where they go and actually do hands-on labs and quizzes that count toward their grade. It's a very intense field trip. And this student is very prone to getting into fights and, you know, finding people who were causing trouble. So at the end of the field trip, I noticed he was off to the side and he was angry. And I was like, Bob, are you okay? And he goes, yeah, I was mad. I'm like, what's wrong? Are you okay? Some kid tried to start a fight with me. Well, did you get into a fight? No, I didn't. What happened? I just walked away. I didn't want to let you or Mr. Z down. I'm sorry. And that's what he said, his words. And I was like, wow. And now Bob passed second semester with a D. Right now, Bob, who passed and failed first semester, is back with us. And he's holding a solid B in physics. And he's doing his skill set in math. He's probably at the middle school set. He's working, he's writing stuff down. He's a model student. It's amazing. And in the reality, I keep thinking, oh man, this is all there now. Taking the time, being the special educator, pulling him aside, really investing in him. And I was a general educator, like, I can't take it anymore, I'm done. He failed, that's it. And it was all him, and I'm so grateful for that, because it helps me remember, you know, and we just had another situation very similar, not more than a week ago. And again, we've been doing this so long that we've kind of lost track of who's the special educator, who's the general educator, and we're both just teaching. And we're just trying to invest the best we can.
Which core competency says you can't tell the general educator from the special educator? Which one is it? That's got it, 11.3? All right.
So that's an example. When we say you can't tell the special education teacher from the general education teacher, or the special education students from the general education students, if you have a student who is in a wheelchair, or who is blind, or deaf, or has no arms, or, I mean, of course I can see that student's getting something different, of course, but we don't make a big deal of it. It's just what we do in the class. If I see that you guys as teachers have decided we're going to divide and conquer, and Bob needs help, and one of us is going to work with Bob right now while the other one runs the show, if that's what you need right then, and that's what Bob needs, and you two decided what worked best, he worked better right now with Mr. Z than Mr. E, hey, that's cool. I went in to observe at a high school once in a different state, and I saw this beautiful lesson plan. I was so excited to see this particular lesson in action because it was gorgeous. It was going to have all different co-teaching approaches. It was great. Cut to real life, where I come in, I sit down, and about 2.5 minutes in, a girl comes in clearly higher than a kite. What'd the co-teachers do? What do you think?
A lot of veterans.
One of them, I mean, she was just feel good. I mean, I'm assuming. But what ended up happening was one of them kept the show going up here, like, shiny object, students, shiny object, eyes up here, big lesson happening, while the other one swooped in, took her and left, and didn't come back for the rest of that period, or a good, like, 35 minutes in, and then eventually came back, jumped right in. And afterwards, they're debriefing with me, and they're like, we are so sorry, you didn't see co-teaching. I'm like, what are you talking about? I saw co-teaching. I saw perfect co-teaching, because something had to happen. And the fact that you guys didn't need to say, are you going to take her? I don't know this part of the lesson. You have to take her, because I don't know. They were just like, I'm closer. And they were able to do that. If you guys can jump in when the phone rings and when, you know, something happens, and you just look at each other and go, I got them, that's beautiful co-teaching. Okay? You want to have this stuff so much under your belt that you're able to move from, wow, we have a whole plan for stations. Oh, wow, there was fire drill, but earthquake drill, let's make it more appropriate to our area. You know, whatever, something happens and you just go, wow, we have to do something different. They're not getting it. Let's change up what we're going to do. That's what we want you to do. I love the examples that you guys have given of things that you expected and didn't expect. I have some tools for you on my website. So if you look at the bottom of the screen right now, it says toteachllc.com. You might want to write that somewhere. I have some tools under the professional development tab. I didn't want to do a lot of individual handouts because some of you will need this and some of you won't. But I have a sheet that's called the Do's and Don'ts of Co-Teaching. For those of you who are trying to get co-teaching started at your school, or you want to have a conversation with your administrators about, ooh, this is what it should be and this is what it shouldn't be, it's a lovely, easy, one-page form that you can download and then use that as a conversation starter about what co-teaching should and shouldn't be. Okay, toteachllc.com. All right, let's move on to another question. I've heard quite a few of you talking about the roles that you've taken, and I think that, by the way, we did not actually plan for Marty to share that story, but he and I have co-taught before, and he had told me that story, and I thought it was perfect for what Mel had shared, so that worked out beautifully for us. The roles and responsibilities that you guys take, just like I said, divide and conquer, even though we co-plan, we co-instruct, we co-assess, it does not mean you all need to sit there together and decide, well, what color paper should we put it on? You know, are we stapling in the upper left-hand corner, or are we going to staple all the way down the side? I mean, some people think they have to do everything together. That's just crazy talk. We don't have time for that. What we have time for is to say, oh, we're teaching mitosis and meiosis. Let's use parallel teaching. I'll teach mitosis. You teach meiosis. Then, after about maybe 20 minutes, let's get kids, get them in twos in each group, and then have them pair up and teach each other what they just learned. Then we'll do some kind of debrief activity and see if they got it all. Cool. That means I have to plan a 20-minute lesson on mitosis. And I better make sure it's engaging and differentiated and right. Because there have been times as a special educator where I'm not quite sure what we're going for here. It's all new math. New math. All right. But if I do know it and you trust me to come up with a good lesson and I trust you that you will do your part and not procrastinate, then we both show up and we've got it done. But we need to be able to divide and conquer on our roles and responsibilities. There are also things that sometimes some of us hold sacrosanct. I have had general educators who say, I have to be the one who takes role. Go for it. That does not bother me at all. My favorite co-teaching experience, hands down, was Dan. He's a history teacher. He and I co-taught, and I co-taught in Virginia and in California. And he and I co-taught, he's now a principal. But my favorite experience is when Dan and I started to co-teach, and we're talking about roles and what we like and what we don't. And he said, I tell you what, here's one thing. I know people are all into this whole project-based learning thing, and we're supposed to get kids up and cutesy activities, and like I need crap on my walls, but I don't do that stuff.
Like, I don't do cutesy. And he was known as a good teacher. He really was. But I don't do cutesy in activities. But I'm good if you want to come up with them, we can do them. I'm like, okay, cool, but what do you like to do? And he said, I like to grade. Right? He said, I like to really see how the kids did, analyze, figure out why they're missing things. I'm like, so let me get this straight. I get to do the cutesy and you'll do the grading. He's like, and that's okay. You know, it could work. Right? And so then ever since then, I've asked people, like, do you like to grade? And they're like, hell no. All right, but I try. Anyway, you guys decide what works for you. And if there are certain things, it does not mean that I never got to see the grades. I definitely did. If he came to me and would say, wow, everybody, you know, 80% of the people miss this question, I could look at it and say, well, I can see why. Or in preparation of giving an assessment, I would have feedback. You know, Dan, I recognize that you saved a lot of paper, but I'm thinking that the 8-point font in all caps, single space, might be difficult for some of the kids to read, and not just the kids with learning disabilities. So, you know, but I had input, but he led that charge, and I led the charge on other things, and then I'd have to bring the stuff, and he'd look at it and go, yes, very creative, Wendy, I love it. It's actually all wrong, but it's creative. So again, you share with one another, and that's what we're looking for, is for you guys to divide and conquer. Now, I've heard at least three different tables and in different permutations a conversation about how we view special educators. I don't know if you all know this, but the special education credential is a real credential. I mean, we're like real boys and girls. I feel like I was a high school German teacher, which has not fared so well for me in California, where being bilingual just means German. I mean, just means Spanish. Anyway, so as a general ed teacher, as a special ed teacher, but as a special ed teacher, people talk to me slowly. Because it's like they think we have the same disabilities as the kids with whom we work. And then add insult to injury, ladies, you'll get this. Being blonde doesn't help. Being cheerleading coach really doesn't help. And how about if you used to do pageants? Right? I had to get a PhD just to be like, I process. Okay? All right, so I've heard this from some of you that you have to work harder if you're a special educator just to prove you know the stuff. But the honest truth is we don't have to know the stuff as well. Should I go into, you know, if I go into to teach physics with Mel's or not, yes, hopefully I will start to learn physics. But will I know it as well as he does? Probably not. It's okay for you not to have the same level of competence in that content area. But what do you have to have if you're the special educator? The ability to differentiate, the competence of differentiation. What else?
Differentiation, scaffolding, being able to individualize it.
Good. Individualization, scaffolding, accommodations, modifications, adaptations, instruction, pedagogy. You should look at the lesson plan and be able to say, here, here, and here, they're not going to get it. Okay, so let's come up with a different way. You're telling us what they need to learn. Great, got that. But let's work together to figure out how to get it to them. And by the way, I don't really understand that problem at all. Right, and that's okay. Now, I don't want my partner to have to feel like they have to teach me first. That was something I heard at high school where a general ed teacher said, I just treat my special ed teacher like she's a really good student. And she had been the, you know, like, department chair and, you know, had won award. I mean, she's a good teacher, but I just treat her like a really good student. I just teach her first and then she can walk around and help people. We've got high school kids who could do that and they're a lot less expensive. Okay, so we want to make sure that if we're actually co-teaching, we're thinking about the roles. One of the tools that I want to give you also in that same place to teach LLC is something called the Share Worksheet. Now, I do know that Granada has used this. Anybody from Granada want to share how you guys have used it?
Yeah,
trying to remember. Okay, good. Thank you. Like, some of them were looking at me like, really? We have? Yes. Good. Name and then.
So my name is Sarah, and actually I knew about the teacher before starting co-teaching because my sister is a special ed co-teacher, and so when I as soon as I heard I was co-teaching, I called her and I was like, what should I do? And she's like, you need to share worksheets. I specifically remember what it was. So it has all these questions on it that you and your co-teachers talk about in advanced interviews. So like I remember one that was talked about, I think it had to do with this. So it's like, what's your philosophy on discipline? And we talked about, like, you know, whatever it is that's going on, like, both co-teachers back each other up. So, like, you know, even if, like, later on you want to be like, oh, maybe next time we'll handle that differently, when it's happening, you're like, she's right, exactly. So things like that, you kind of, like, talk about your expectations going in, which is helpful because then you can try to match each other in that way and figure out in advance if there's, we'll see you guys.
Good, thank you. Want to add? No? You're good? Good. Others? Party, you've used it for a while?
Never?
You don't even know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, the share worksheet, I like to go back to almost every other year just because I find just to work through the different parts. You know, as an educator, you're constantly changing and evolving and making sure that both me and the co-teacher I'm working with, that we feel good about what we're doing currently. You know, so how do you feel about what we've been doing with classroom management? Well, I like this, but last year I didn't really like how this worked out. We need to change that. Or, you know, this discipline area that we decided to do it this way, well, that's not really working well. Let's try it this way. So, again, the share worksheet's always nice for me because I just keep coming back to it. Hey, let's talk about this, let's talk about that. And it as a reflection tool for how it's going and what we can do different.
Thank you. I'm on this side. So share is about sharing your hopes, your attitudes, your expectations. You are going to say, this is how I think the co-teaching class should run. That's what I believe. This is what I think my partner is going to do. And you fill it out individually first because the backside, as they were saying, is like a lot of pet peeves. This is what I think about discipline, but also how do you think about student talking? What do you think about homework? How do you do, what about classwork? Okay, how should they relate to me? How should they relate to you? So there's a lot of little pet peeves on there, and you're able to share exactly what you think, and you do it individually first so that when the two of you sit down, you're able to compare notes. And co-teaching is frequently referred to as a professional marriage. So you know that the kids are gonna try and play mom against dad. You wanna make sure, like she said, even if you disagree and later you're gonna say, I totally didn't agree with you on that, but right then you do. So that you have a chance to talk about it. Or you talk about it with your partner in front of the students, but you do it very respectfully and differentially so that they figure out that you're trying to work this out. So that's a tool for you. I wanna know what types of relationships you guys have come up with, or what are some things that you guys have done to share the role, share the responsibility, because we've already mentioned multiple times that time is a problem. I would love to hear how some of you guys have divided and conquered in terms of roles and responsibilities that work for you. Nobody's figured it out. So you're like, still working on that one. Hi, what's your name? Mercy.
So right now I'm co-teaching with an English teacher and special ed. And she does not like writing on the board or typing. So with English, as you're modeling set of sentences, paragraph, we expect I do all the writing.
Oh, good.
And still input it. So that really works.
Okay, so finding out that your partner does not like to write on the board, and yet in an English class they want to have the modeling, so you guys have decided, good, she doesn't like to write, do that. I had a partner, also an English teacher, who, interestingly enough, could not spell at all. Just really, really poor speller, and I'm a pretty good speller. So that was another thing where she would say, okay, look, I'm gonna write stuff. This is, she was the general ed teacher. She'd write it up in the morning because she was there earlier. But we had a deal that I would do a drive-by right before school started just to check because we didn't co-teach until like third period, and she didn't wanna have kids writing things down or noticing that, you know, she'd have to. But that's a great one, okay? So one person knows they're always in charge of the writing. What's something else that you guys have come up with where, hey, I'm always kind of doing this piece? Or typically. Yeah, good. What's your name?
Granada. One of the things that I do, I'm actually co-teaching with a science, so I do physics and he does chemistry, but I'm co-teaching chemistry.
Cool.
And one of the things that I really like labs, and so planning it out, setting it up, while he does like the lecture portion of it, it actually kind of helps me.
It's great. Yeah. And that's a great example. If you guys are doing parallel teaching where you divide the class in half, what you could do is Brenda could actually not just have set up the lab, she could run the lab, especially there are times when we don't have enough science materials for everyone, or in doing the lecture and having kids get into the book, we know we've got kids who don't read well. We have students who don't follow along in order to answer the questions that get left behind. Brenda could be running the lab with half of the students while the other half are staying with the other teacher, the other co-teacher, who's working with them on taking notes and doing the lecture, and then they flip-flop and do it again. Now, typically, there's this mindset that we have as teachers that I have to do direct instruction and modeling, and then we're going to have guided practice, and then we're going to get to independent practice, because God knows we've taught you that in teacher ed over and over. And yet, if I told you guys I have the coolest video game, it's really, really cool. You're going to love it. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to talk to you about it for 45 minutes. I'm going to tell you everything about this video game there is to know. I'm going to show you exactly how to do it and all the tricks of the trade and stuff like that. I'm going to stand with you and do it with you. And then eventually you can play the video game. Are you excited? Not so much. No, not so much. What do you guys want to do? Play the game. But you don't know how to play the game. You're going to figure it out, aren't you? You're going to make mistakes. And then when you make mistakes, what are you going to do? You're going to learn, or you're going to totally look off your neighbor, and that's okay too. Because in the real world, that's what most of us do is, I don't get the straw, can you help me out? Right? We ask ourselves. So one of the things we have to think about is some kids, some of our students, would actually do better with our content if we throw them in. Let them work out those problems. Let them go straight to the lab before they do the lecture notes. Know your students. There are certainly some students who need us to scaffold and need us to walk them through step by step by step, but don't just assume that it has to be that way. All right, so you've got the share worksheet. Now, I've already mentioned, we know we've got our three parts, co-plan, co-instruct, co-assess. I think most of you already talked about the need for planning time, but I want to know if any of these, anything else that has been more challenging for you or something that's been positive for you about these three. Good. Your name? Okay, Sue?
Well, one of the real benefits of co-teaching, I find, is being able to bounce ideas off of one another. And as you talk, you come up with even more ideas. So I think it's really wonderful to have a co-teacher.
Good. So being able to bounce ideas, you're getting brain dead. You're like, I can't figure this out. You've got somebody there to kind of help you out. I think it's also important to note there's a variety of permutations of co-teaching in this room. So for example, a lot of schools start with, oh, we have to do it in resource. Resource, our old resource classes, they're the ones co-teaching. With Granada, they have a lot of the SDC students who are typically in self-contained classes, who are going into even the physics classes and chemistry classes and things like that. Some of you have, like we just heard of, two gen ed teachers, who, right? You're both gen ed, who are co-teaching. We have two special ed teachers who are co-teaching. People are getting very creative in order to meet student needs, and I love that. You had your hand up as well.
Yes, my name is Malik.
Okay.
If you don't mind, I would like for you guys to share on the second one for the positives, as far as the platforms that you have used in order to improve the planning, are you loading lesson plans or worksheets to a particular platform that works for you that maybe the rest of us can use?
Does anybody want to share on something like that? And by the way, next time we're meeting, we're doing all co-planning all the time. So definitely come prepared with how do you co-plan, what's worked for you, what are you struggling with, but also those of you who have different ways that you have successfully negotiated time with co-planning. We'd love to hear it. Name first.
I'm Brittany. This is my co-teacher. We don't have that much time to co-plan, so a way that we kind of get around that is we share a drive and share folders in Google Drive. So there are things that we can both look at and both edit, like slide presentations or Google Docs assignments that we're going to give out. So that way, if either one of us is planning something, we can kind of co-plan together, even if we're not in the same space.
Excellent. Thank you. And we're finding more and more it's that issue of we can't be in the same exact place, so finding other ways that work. Okay, right here.
There's
first name.
Jessica.
Good.
We started co-teaching this year, and I know that one of my teachers, when we were planning, we were going over lesson plans, and she is using an app that is called planbook.com, and it's $12 for the whole year. And it's really interesting because it's the first time I heard about the program. But it helps you, let's say if you're out one day, you can extend the lessons, or if there's, you know, something, an event that happened or the students didn't get it, you can expand the lesson or the activity, depending on what they need. So
nice.
It's really cool.
Yeah. So planbook.com. I'm also going to share with you, and I'll put it up right now down there. It's going to be coming up in a minute, but also on the 2Teach website, I have a lesson plan database. So it has examples of lesson plans at the different levels, different subjects, and it has a free template that you can download that is for co-teaching specifically, because there's a place for general educator, a place for special service provider, and it can be universally designed in that you can upload it to Google Docs. You can put it on Mac, PC, whatever you want, and use it that way. So again, these will be things we'll go back to next time, revisit some of these specific things and planning strategies. One more.
Hi, my name is Lucy, and this year, Brenda started a STEM mentor program at our school where students are tutors in classes that they've already taken and have been successful in. She does a little bit of pedagogy training with them. But then the students also have to work one-on-one with the teacher that they're a STEM mentor for. And I use Google Classroom, and my STEM mentors are actually co-teachers with me on the Google Classroom. We can share documents, and we can discuss seating charts based on grades to create heterogeneous groups and things like that. So I use Google Classroom with both my STEM mentors and also teachers who have common preps.
It's wonderful. That's why we're doing this community, guys. You have great ideas. Love it. Okay, let's see. I think we got that. So this one is about, I'm moving us into, we're about to get in groups. I want us to talk a little bit about the actual instruction, the co-teaching in terms of the instruction part. Again, we're going to come back to the plan, and we're going to come back to all of these. This is our more general workshop tonight. But one of the issues that we do here is when special educators at the high school level feel like, I don't know math as well, I don't know social studies, English, I read Odyssey, or I never understood the whole whale thing. So whatever it is, we need to be thinking of the strategies. We mentioned that we need to be experts in differentiation and adaptation, but what does that look like when you're actually teaching together? And I want you to think of that question. When we're about to break up and have you go into subject-specific groups, I want you to think about what specifically is the general educator going to do and what specifically is the special educator going to do? What are you bringing to the table? So don't just say, you know, like I said, okay, well, I'll do mitosis, you do meiosis. Okay, that's fine, that's good. That's using parallel teaching to teach content. But then what would we do to make sure that the students actually learned what mitosis and meiosis are, that they learn whatever the major content that we're trying to drive is? Okay? So think of that question. One of the cheat sheets that I have for you on the website also is called a co-teaching approaches worksheet. And all that is it has the five co-teaching, co-instructional approaches, which are team teaching, one teach, one support, station teaching, parallel teaching, and alternative teaching. Each of those five is broken down with what it is, what it looks like, what it shouldn't look like, has a little picture. So you guys will be able to take that, print it. I suggest laminate it and stick it next to your desk or put it in your planning book. So that every time you're meeting with your partner, you're using that to not just always default to one teach, one support. A lot of people default to one teach, one support. So we're about to get in. I think, would everybody feel comfortable if we just got into math, science, social studies, English? Does that cover, or do we need a social skills as well? Social skills as well, maybe? Okay, so there'll be five groups. Social skills, life skills, whatever you want to call that group. Are there elementary? Is it just one school that's elementary? There are more. Huh? Is there anybody elementary? No, I didn't think so. Okay, so I think we're just secondary. So is everybody good? You would have some place to go if we broke into those four? Okay. As we do this, this five, we'll do the five. Everybody please listen to the directions. And that way at least somebody in your group will know what to do. At least one. You're going to go into, and I will tell you where to go, but you're going to go into subject-specific groups. There's a lot of math people here. I do not want to see a group of 25 people standing in a circle that isn't conducive to real sharing. Once you get into the large subject group, start finding your peeps. Right? Who else teaches that math that you do? Or is that a different, is it a different school but something similar? Start to get into smaller discussion groups so that you can truly share. Some of you won't remember or won't know what these five co-teaching approaches are. You'll be confused about them. Those of you with a lot of experience in co-teaching, help share. Here's what stations are. Here's what alternative is. I will be walking around as well to help you out with that. Your goal is to come up with at least an example, at least one example of how you would use a co-teaching approach that's regrouping, meaning parallel, where you divide them into groups, station, where you drive them in multiple groups and they go around, and alternative, where it's large group, small group. I don't want to just hear, the two of us stood up front and we both taught that subject. That's too easy, right? So team teaching, one teach, one support, you can talk about, but that's not your goal. Goal is at least one lesson where you could use a regrouping approach that's concrete, that's specific to your subject, so we really know what it would look like. Any questions? Yes.
You can teach two different subjects.
You get to pick. That's the whole, that's my differentiation for the moment. Choice. You guys all have choice. Go where you would like. And again, Granada people, because you have had more of these experiences than some of the others, make sure you help people know what these different approaches are. Let's do this. Let us have... Don't move yet. English and English related. Back that way. Math over by the cookies. There's a lot of them. I'm helping my group. English, math, science in this corner. English, math, science, social studies in this corner. English, math, science, social studies, life skills, social skills in the middle. All right? Go. How about 10 minutes? Oh, are the cookies gone? Okay. Yeah, sure. As long as the people who would normally be in the middle find you, you're fine.
Bounce around,
I think, to make sure that people know the approaches are, because we might have some new people who are like, yeah, especially the three regrouping approaches. Unless science ends up being nobody, but I think there should be more people. Right. They were doing this about 10 minutes. That's it. Thank you. photographers.
Yeah.
typically have warm-ups that you prepare, then one of you is just always doing the warm-ups. One of you is always doing the test reviews. One of you is always doing the photocopy. So you have a file where if something needs to be photocopied for any class, it goes in the file with a post-it note on it, and one of you says, that's my job, where your job is uploading anything to the website or taking old pieces of paper, scanning them in, and putting them on PowerPoint. Think of tasks that you both feel comfortable with, and then if you just say, that's my task, you don't have to figure out, well, I'll do it for math if you do it for English, and if you do it, then it, I think I would just start feeling like, yeah, there's so much.
Yeah.
different approaches were. So that was pretty exciting. Okay, because it was clear that some of you, you've been there, you've done that, you know this stuff. Some veteran co-teachers that I speak with say they like hearing these over and over again because sometimes you'll forget. You'll know them cognitively, but they don't work their way into your everyday practice. So you'll have things where you go, okay, you know what, we do team teaching all the time, and actually we do parallel all the time, but we almost never do stations. We just kind of forget that, or you know, whatever. So sometimes as you're talking, hopefully we're talking about how you could do it in your actual subject. So I have my LaCouche ball. I need to hear from somebody. Hopefully your team actually talked about the different co-teaching approaches and didn't just talk about other stuff. So let me find out, what is your name, sir? Hi, Albert, what subject did you go to? How was the English group? Pretty good?
Great.
Were they great? Did they talk?
The entire time.
The entire time they talked. Okay, let's find out what they talked about. Albert, ready? Tell us one co-teaching approach that you could use in English.
One particular strategy that I found very interesting is this idea of bringing essays together. So you take the same essay and you both read it and you come up with a, not a rubric, but you see how you grade it. Yeah, you calibrate the essay, right? You calibrate the grade. And then once you establish how to grade that particular essay, then you go and split them and you both grade them and then you kind of trade off that way.
So. Okay, excellent. Thank you so much. May I have my little kickball back? I know you want it. Okay. Not a co-teaching instructional approach, but very good for co-assessing. So we still did get a very helpful strategy. All right, let me see. Somebody haven't used you. Over here, what's your name, sir?
Larry.
Larry, okay, Larry, what subject did you go to?
Math.
Okay, let's see if you got any ideas for how we can teach math and co-teach. You're next.
Okay, pretty much I was trying to get some insight about pre-calculus that I never took it in high school.
Okay.
So I'm paired up with a pre-cal teacher. So I was trying to find out ways how the students can learn. It's like I'm almost like the student in the classroom in a sense, trying to learn the content. And I was telling the pre-cal teacher, like, sometimes I'm in the classroom and I don't understand what's going on after the lesson is being taught tonight. I can only imagine what the students are feeling.
Right.
So I like what you said earlier when you said it's okay to say, hey, I don't think the kids are getting it.
Yes, I think that's huge.
And then also, like, when he did some reviews, like Algebra 2, I was like, whoa, wait a minute, I know how to do this. So it's like the alternative station, maybe if I could help the students learn the steps before the actual pre-cal lesson, you know, maybe that's a way to how I could be more involved in the classroom and get the kids caught up with their skill levels so they can, you know, get the pre-cal stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so Larry mentioned two of them actually. So one could be the role of one teach, one support. If you are walking around and you realize, I don't understand what my partner just said, and if I don't get it, I'm looking around and the majority of the students are looking like the deer in the headlights and they don't get it, that's a really good time to say, hey, co-teacher, I think we need a brain break. And that means I need to talk to you. And or you could say, I think we need to go back over that. I'm not sure I get it. And it's okay to say, I don't get it, because the students are thinking, thank gosh, somebody else doesn't get it. So having that communication is really important. The other thing Larry said is, if this isn't my subject, I'm not as strong in pre-calc as the gen ed teacher is, and maybe even than some of the students are, I could still have the role of pre-teaching some of the foundational skills that I do know that I can make sure the students also have so we're ready to take that next step. So those are appropriate. Oh, young lady, I'm never gonna get that back in my... Okay.
Thank you.
You can play later. Bye-bye, thank you. Yikes, that was a bad move on my part. Okay, moving far away from young child who's gonna take this. What's your name? Monica, what do you teach?
Is it
English? Oh, we did English. You are off the hook, young lady. Okay. All right, let's see. What's your name? Michelle, what do you teach?
Math.
We had. Do you teach pre-calc? Algebra 2. Who does pre-calc? Oh, come on. I want somebody to. All right. So later, I want you to introduce yourself to Larry. What's your name? Oh, you were. we're talking? Excellent, good. I want to make some connections here so you guys can help each other out. Social studies, I need a social studies person. Who's social studies over here? Okay, wait a minute, people over, yeah, but you guys have been talking. I want to get somebody who wasn't. Oh yeah, Hat Boy. All right, sir. Hat Boy, what's your name?
Hi.
Hi. What's your name?
Toteca.
Okay. Excellent. Tell us, what is one way you could use a co-teaching instructional approach for social studies?
I think differentiation stations, as we call them, where basically different students are at different levels in their understanding of the content, right? And then have each teacher help break it. Those that are ready at a certain level with it, help them advance their understanding even more. And those who need help with it, help them get to a place that we can come back together. And even both the student groups can help teach each other, right? But they have that time with each teacher originally, it helps them scaffold it to the necessary level that each one needs to before coming back together.
All right, excellent. And they call it differentiation stations. Okay, I'm going to clarify language just because sometimes what I say might be different than how you guys use it. You don't have to change your language, just know what I'm talking about. So when I talk about stations, I'm talking about them being, there being movement, right? So the kids are all learning typically the same thing, although it can be differentiated within it, but they go around and move and rotate stations. Parallel teaching, I'm talking about two groups. They might be doing the same content, but they could also be doing different content. So in Torteca, right, in your situation, they might be getting, one is getting some scaffolded material related to the content, the other is getting enrichment. So they're in two groups, but then they can come back together and maybe help each other out. That's fine. Okay, and then so that was stations and parallel. Alternative is large group and small group for pre-teaching, reteaching, or enrichment. And then of course team teaching, we're both up front, we're both sharing the stage. One teach, one support, one of us has the lead and the other one is doing the support role. I understand that someone has had a recent experience with station teaching and maybe it was a good experience. Raise your hand if you've had a good experience with station teaching recently. All right, excellent. Would you please share that, because I know it was, here you go, a science experience.
Sure. For Saturday, I don't remember the specific content that you're teaching. It's been an entire week. But we had been delivering kind of the same stuff for a couple days again, done some great lecturing, and done, I forget what it is, we're out the front, in the back, or vice versa.
One teach, one support.
We've been doing some of that, and then, you know, there was a lot of, like, you know, slack jaws, you know, glassy eyes, you know, knuckle dragging, and that sort of thing. But when we did this, we split up in four different teams, four different groups. We have an adult aide, and the class was very good, and then the two of us each took one of the groups, and there were about 8 or 9 kids per group. And then the final group was, we just had, I think we read a paper or something, it was some directions, there was some support. There was no adult support for them, but those were the four groups. And I felt like the kids came to my group, that I was much better able to serve them. I felt like, you know, the 8 or 9 kids who were in the group were totally engaged, and the few kids who might have otherwise zoned out were directly looking at me, and they were participating, and they were much more likely to participate, whereas when, you know, the whole group instruction, they were less likely to. And so I was blown away. I was literally, I don't say that often, that sort of thing often, but I was literally blown away that we had some stagnation, and then just we did that, and it totally changed everything, and I thought it was a very successful day. So,
yay! You know. Woohoo! Glad to hear it. Thank you. So that reminds me of an experience I had. I went to a high school in, it's actually in Paramount, and I had been told by the administrators to watch out for a team because they needed to divorce. This was a very bad team. They were boring. The kids hated them. It had behavior problems, etc. So I went in one day, and I actually saw, I don't know what to call it, but it was an instruction. So one teacher was literally yelling at the kids, yelling at them, and the other teacher was standing cowering in the back. That's all I saw. And I was scheduled to go see this team again the next day, and I thought, really? I have to do, I mean, because I get paid to sit and watch and take notes and give positive feedback, and there's me thinking, will they notice if I take out my phone? What else can I, she scares me. And so I have to go on the next day. Well, we had debriefed afterwards, and I had said, look, I don't see, your role, you were, in my opinion, not even an aide. I didn't see you walking around helping kids. You never once spoke. Other person, have you thought of the military as a second career? Anyway, so we debriefed. The next day I went in to see them, and it was night and day. The kids were doing, they were doing stations and small groups, and what they had, they only had two adults in the room, but the special educator had gone right outside. There were some, like, tables and chairs out there, shook the group out. They were doing some stuff. The general ed teacher was yelling, but at a smaller group, right? At less damage at one time. And then they had another group where they had taken a worksheet, was math, and they had taken, they cut it all up so the kids thought they were doing like a game, an activity. And the students were so engaged. And when we debriefed afterwards, they were like, you know, we just took our lesson and like in 10 minutes, we're just like, okay, she wants to see something, fine. You know, you go do this group, I'll do this group, and we can have these kids, we'll cut it up, fine. So in 10 minutes, we'll do this. And I have no idea why the kids were so good today, because usually we have to send like 10 of them out of the room. Yeah, I have no idea why they were so good today. Could it be you were engaging them? I'm going out on a limb. They were doing something different. It was interesting to them. So they were doing something. So we just got to remember, if you're bored by what's going on, they probably are too. All right, moving right along, because I know what time it is. All right, one teach, one support is overused. As we come back in the next few weeks, every time we meet, I really want this to be one of our major things that we're thinking about, is how do we avoid overusing one teach, one support? How do we avoid always making it feel like one of us is up front and one of us is just walking around passing out papers, answering questions? It's certainly easier. And if you don't have a lot of time to plan, it is the default. Weiss and Lloyd's research, national research, found that 80% of teachers who say they're co-teaching use one teach, one support 80% of the time. Okay, we gotta watch that. All right, so how do you not overuse it? Again, I mentioned this to you guys before, but this was also back to your question, Jose, was co-teaching lesson plan template. You can find this, now this one's under the lessons database. So the other ones were under professional development tab, this one is gonna be under the database. It's a free lesson plan template, feel free to print it out. When we meet next time, we'll be talking about co-planning strategies. So I just want one or two share outs, last minute thing, but is there anything that you guys wish that someone would have told you in advance of co-teaching that would have helped demystify co-teaching for you? Something that you've learned that you go, ah, now I get it better. Something you wish someone would have told you to demystify co-teaching for you.
Laugh often. All right? Joke around with your students. Band with them. Tell them an occasional story. And above all, have fun. That's what you start with. That's what you end with. The first day Marty and I talked, I wasn't quite sure what to do. Marty just has an amazing sense of humor. Nice time to drive. And all right, he just started bantering with me, and we just fell right into it. And that's been kind of an MO for us ever since. And the kids love it, we love it, and it keeps it fun.
That's wonderful, thank you. And I do have a video we'll see at some point of these two. And ultimately, that's what everybody says, is they look like they're enjoying their time together. Are you enjoying the time with your co-teacher? Hopefully, you're finding it a rewarding experience, not a frustrating one. So even if you haven't gotten to where you can use all the different co-teaching approaches, or you can plan at the level that you wish you were planning, if you enjoy the time and you feel like, I'm learning something from this person, and I've got someone to vent to, and sometimes I can use the restroom, and that's awesome. Get the benefits where you can get the benefits. We'll take it all. As we move forward, we're wrapping it up. Are there any last questions that any of you would like to share that you have? We may not be able to address them right now, but it's something that I can keep on my radar for the sessions that we have in the future. Questions that you want answered, not necessarily that will be answered right now. Questions that you want answered. Yes, sir.
In reflecting on your all out here, which sounds amazing in so many ways, for those who are at smaller schools, just not having the resource to have that many teachers, not that many special ed teachers, how can we approach that? And, you know, maybe we'll address that.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. Just throw out questions because this is helpful for me to think about what might you need. And certainly we've got schools that have different resources, different levels, and different numbers of people.
Examples, resources of differentiated instruction.
Okay, excellent. Want some more examples, concrete examples of differentiated instruction at the high school level?
Also, if it can be like very content specific, that'd be great.
Okay, good. So making sure that we're very content specific at the high school level and differentiated. What else? What do you want?
I need assistance, tools, help with classroom management, but not just me, but helping my co-teachers.
Yeah, partner.
Yeah, and okay. Manage the classes.
Yeah, classroom management, especially if you might have two different ways of doing it.
Maybe something like best practices for administrators and like about boundaries and like when you first start the class and people are going to meet, like what should be happening and who should say what, like your share thing, what's a positive even though I haven't looked at it. But then you don't have to think like what question should I ask the teacher, because I do, I go up to them, I'm like, what are your pet peeves? But they're just like, why is she asking me that? And I don't want it to be like I have to explain all of that. It's kind of like the administrator's job more than my job, I think.
Okay, so helping administrators know how to set this up so that it's more systematic. Okay, good. Other questions? And I want to remind all of you guys, I'm going to have my email up here in just a second, right there at the bottom. If you think of questions that you're hoping in the next five times that we meet that we will address, do look at those five categories so that you realize that we already have some major topics, but within those major topics, we can put some of these questions in there. Feel free to ask me questions. Feel free to ask Marty questions, and he can get them to me. Again, I would like us to all thank Granada Hills for hosting this as we build the community. And thank you all for coming. We do want to keep sharing with one another and keep building this as a way to help kids. So have a great evening, and thanks for being here.